Dear excellencies and guests, my name is Filip Radunovic and I'm working at the Erste Foundation as a project manager. In the name of the foundation and daily newspaper Die Presse, I would like to welcome all of you to our very first debate of our newly established European match series. Erste Foundation, as some of you might know, worked during the last 10 years in the fields of cultural, social and European integration, aiming towards supporting civil society in Central and Southeastern Europe with the quality journalism and support of investigative journalism being one of our main foci. We supported in that period more than 1,000 projects, which is an astonishing number, in more than 15 countries, which shaped the social and cultural landscapes of the region, among them initiating debates on various levels. As tonight's subtitle implies, controversies and encounters, with this series we will take on a new approach with a new kind of encounters, dealing with burning topics, contemporary topics from Central and Southeastern Europe. Seeing you in such a huge number tonight is more than a proof that there is not only a plain public interest for the ongoing conflict in Ukraine, so there must be something more at stake behind the whole issue. I'll try to explain our interest for Ukraine and the ongoing conflict in particular. It's not only the geographical vicinity. I may remind you that the most western city of Ukraine, Ushkorod, is much closer to Vienna than the most western city of Vienna, Bludenz. But there are many other socio-political aspects which go much deeper and imply all of our lives. 2014 marked many anniversaries, some of them being reminded as the tragic ones in our collective memory, the centennial of World War I, 75 years of the start of World War II. But also we had some more pleasant memories, like the fall of the Berlin Wall, celebrated just a couple of weeks ago, or the 10 years since the largest EU enlargement towards the East. We all witnessed, and I'm thinking also of many of you in the audience, different events, debates, conferences. Yet, I am speaking for me personally, but also from my colleagues in the Foundation, we felt a very bitter taste which surrounded all of these celebrations and shiny events, which you also, some of you, probably attended. And I'm not talking about the emerging conflicts in Europe and its immediate neighborhood, but there is a general feeling that at the end of 2014, there is a certain need or certainty that contemporary history has to be rewritten, be it the European history, the post-Soviet history, or respective post-socialist history. So we at Erste Foundation did ask ourselves if it is possible to agree on a common discourse about what really happened after 1989. Did the binaries of the Cold War really collapse, or did they only get substituted by some new ghosts of the Berlin Wall which shifted towards the East? And why did we as Europeans, and I'm not only quoting at the Austrians, but taking Europe as a whole, why did we allow that our sovereignty in the 21st century is being defined mainly by the forces who control the spaces and situations of exception, to quote Carl Schmitt? And we have many of those spaces of exception today. You know all of them, be it in Guantanamo or Abkhazia, be it Fortress Europe, with the death tolls in front of Lampedusa, or be it the everyday victims in the Donbas. So the fundamental question to us as engaged citizens and representatives of the third sector is, if we can really allow our states to legitimize respective actions which appear as realpolitik answers to these certain exceptions of reality. And if we legitimize them, are we really aware that thereby we are destroying our very own, very European values and fundaments, like the rule of law, human rights, principles of our own liberalism, and getting dangerously close towards, and I'm quoting Yevgeny Zamyatin's dystopian State One from his novel We. Besides this danger which we face, there is also the question of language and its use and misuse, being most of the time articulated through mass media. use language and have everyday level to reflect upon our realities, be it the ones from the Ministry of Love or the Ministry of Truth. And I'm quoting here George Orwell and his 1984 novel, which we need, I think, which is in the year 2014, a judgment about the state Europe is in. We need that novel in order to recall the discrepancies between the real and surreal, between reality and lies. Tonight we will hear much about it, I'm sure. So, to paraphrase Clausewitz, I think it's time to ask that we should maybe reconsider that the Cold War, and therefore Fukuyama's end of history, really ended with 1989, or did it was continued just by other means? The question reflects the core problems of the political binaries of the 21st century, out of which the Ukrainian conflict is only probably Europe's most painful symptom, with the clash of ideologies being only substituted by a deeper clash of realities. We witness these opposing realities every day when we see Mrs. Merkel not being able to understand Mr. Putin's actions and worldviews, or where Mr. Putin cannot grasp the notion of Mrs. Merkel's European universalism and the values which she's trying to defend. Therefore, we at Erste Foundation dedicated today's debate to raise awareness and engage into new territories with representatives of opposing realities, to offer you, the Viennese audience, a debate which will try to recap what social and political causes lie behind these spaces of exception. And for our very first topic, the media war, we invited very prominent actors from Kiev and Moscow who engaged into this phenomenon on an everyday level. In harsh and difficult conditions like they face on every day, we are very happy to have them here with us and that they made it safely all the way to Vienna. Also, we have to excuse two persons, Mr. Udo Ulfkotte, who unfortunately was a victim of the Lufthansa strikes and had to cancel his appearance last minute. And also Mrs. Oksana Zabushko, who unfortunately had a death case in her family. Nevertheless, I would like to thank personally all of our speakers who made the way to us here tonight. And I would like to mention two persons, very special persons, also to thank them, and two journalists from Daily Die Presse, who are waving the flag of quality and independent journalism with their coverage of the Ukraine crisis, extensive coverage throughout the last months. Thank you, Jutta Sommerbauer and Christian Ulch, our moderator of tonight. I wish you all an inspiring and engaging discussion and evening, and to say it in the words of all of us here, thank you, danke, spasiba I djakujem.
Well, thank you, Philip, for opening up this wide intellectual space. I'm going to try to bring it down to earth now. We're four journalists sitting here. I'm happy that you all came here. It's not so easy for you. It's really an irony that the person living closest to Vienna, Udo Ulfkotte, couldn't come because of the strike of Lufthansa. Let me briefly introduce the debaters. To my right hand is Oksana Boyko. She's been with RT, formerly known as Russia Today, for quite a while now. Right now, she's anchoring a geopolitical discussion show called Worlds Apart. Yeah. Maybe this will give us also a hint for this discussion today. To my left is Katya Gorchinskaya. She's deputy editor-in-chief of the Kiev Post. It's an English language newspaper in Kiev, widely known. I'm glad that you came here, as well as Mr. Yevgeny Fedchenko. He used to be a journalist. I learned that you knew each other from former days. You used to work for TV stations. Right now you're educating future journalists. You're a professor in a journalism school. And you have founded a very interesting project called Stop Fake Org, which deals with what you call fake information. Let me jump into the discussion. Let me say before, this is a very heated subject. I know that very well because I get a lot of emails every time I write about Russia and Ukraine. So please keep it disciplined. There is enough emotion in it. So I would prefer that we discuss in a rational and rather sober way. What makes this discussion so interesting is that what I've learned before that you've never encountered before. So Vienna, this discussion here is an opportunity for you to exchange your viewpoints, which brings me to the subject of this evening. What I find fascinating in this conflict is that there are two totally different narratives on this crisis. They are juxtaposed in a way. I cannot remember a conflict where it has been so in such a stark way like this. So let me ask and begin with you, Oksana, about your take on the chain of events in Ukraine, which differs from the way things are reported from the Ukrainian side, and also from Western media. You, from the beginning, had a very, you portrayed the protest in Maidan Square, for instance, in a way which somehow portrayed the demonstrators as being tightly connected to fascists, and you portrayed the whole opposition movement as some sort of fascist danger for Ukraine. So could you elaborate on that and simply give us your view on things?
Well, good evening all. Thank you for being here, and thank you to the Erste Foundation for hosting this, I think, very valuable discussion. It is a rare opportunity for Russians and Ukrainians to engage directly. Usually, such encounters turn into a screaming match at best. Sometimes it gets physical. So okay. That's...
Don't worry.
I think Austria is a very fitting place given your reputation and foreign policy direction of neutrality. I think that's very valuable. Now, I disagree with the two things that you said. One is that we portrayed from the very beginning the protest movement at Maidan as entirely being fueled by Nazi or fascist ideology. That's not true. And I mean, when I say we, I primarily speak for the channel that I work for, because I mean, I think we will be talking here about in very generic terms, and you know, such generalizations as Russian media, Western media, or Ukrainian media, I don't think are entirely accurate or helpful for the discussion. Having said that, I think there is a strain of Russian journalists and Russian people who do see nationalist danger in what is happening in Ukraine, and perhaps who stress the Nazi parallels. And to explain you why this happened, I have to start a little bit from afar, because before doing my program, I was a war reporter. I reported from Libya, from Syria, and this is another point that I disagree with you on, because in those conflicts, the differences in perspectives between Russia and the West were also apparent, less so in Libya, because I think also because of fakes and clever media manipulation, or perhaps complicity, I'm not quite decided on that yet. I think the fate of Libya was decided in public media court, and because of that, Russia joined with the West in Russia abstained from the resolution of the Security Council to authorize the no-fly zone, but it allowed the West to take action. And we can talk about that in more details, but it was very clear from the very beginning that...
Let's talk about Ukraine. I mean,
it's... Yeah, but what I want to stress is that I think both in Libya and in Syria, each camp saw what they wanted to see happening in those countries. Because from the very beginning, Western media portrayed that as a democratic uprising. You know, that's what, I'm not saying that they are conditioned to see that, but that's what they see when they see people demonstrating. And if you look, if you talk to people on the ground, it wasn't entirely political. It was, there was a strain of protesters who were political, who wanted Jeffersonian democracy, but the nature of those protests was primarily economic. Now, what Russians see when they looked at what was happening at the Arab Spring was disintegration of social order, the West trying to impose its version of how events should be run on the region that is not fit for that. And that was, of course, everything coming on the top of what happened in Iraq, and also influenced by Russia's own experience. You know, we are a country that's been through many revolutions. We suffered from that, and people in Russia do fear disintegration of social order and chaos and bloodshed.
So,
I'm finishing my point. When events in Ukraine started to occur, I think some of the media landscape, some of the journalists, and I think war journalists are, both in Russia and in any other countries, they tend to be the same people. I mean, they just come from one zone, war zone to another, you know, they cover conflict. So they apply to what was happening in Ukraine the same lenses, both the Western reporters and the Russian reporters. And I think what we saw from the very beginning, it's hard to dispute that. I think there are evidence of that. There is evidence of that, that there were some far-right forces present in Maidan, some forces who would give, for example, you know, who had swastikas, who would give the what looked like Nazi salute. I'm not saying that those forces were predominant. I'm not saying that those forces were sort of leading the crowd. I think Putin said that in the beginning of Maidan, that he understands the concerns of the people, that people were protesting against the corrupt system, you know, that it was motivated by true democratic aspirations. But I think he also thought that the West, as usual, was very quick to jump on the bandwagon and to destabilize situation with no clear outcome. And what, from the Russian perspective, what we see happening in Ukraine is the same that we saw happening in Libya and Syria. People starting with, you know, good aspirations, the West nudging them towards violence to, you know, achieve their political goals, and then leaving and essentially throwing the country to the wolves. And I mean, I think we, Ukraine is a bit different for all of us because we have family ties, and this is a country that I think most Russians care deeply about. But I think the presence of violence, this is the thing that scares us the most. The Russian media and the Russian people, as well as the Russian government.
Okay, Katya, please.
Well, obviously I have an extremely different perspective on the whole revolution thing. Very, very different from Russian. And first of all, I will disagree entirely that this was an economic protest, which is a point that was made before. There is a reason why this revolution is called the Euromaidan revolution at first, because people initially rose when the government backed out of its own decision to sign an association agreement with Europe, an agreement that would bring us closer, but not quite into full membership with the European Union. Stage two of this revolution, or the first escalation of this revolution, came when our government attacked its own people, when they unleashed the police against its own people, and students who were staying the night on Maidan were beaten brutally, and the footage of it was shown all across the world. And this is when it became personal for just about every resident of Ukraine, and when this peaceful uprising became what we now call the revolution of dignity. Because the sense in the people was very much that we cannot allow the government to do this to us. We are human beings. We elected you. We delegated you the power. You have to treat us with respect. We want dignity. And it wasn't just about the students and the beating. It was about redefining the relationship between the society and the government. It was about setting the boundaries and the checks and controls for the government. This is what the revolution was all about. it was interesting to hear that Russia is afraid of uprisings and revolutions. I mean, guys, you don't need to be afraid. It's a different country. And this is a point that a lot of Russians tend to forget. Ukraine is a very different country. We technically have a border between the two countries. And the fact that a revolution is happening in Ukraine doesn't really necessarily have consequences for Russia.
Well, but it does. And I think it, I'm sorry, just a very quick note. I think it does consequences not only for Russia, which is just across the border, but for the United States that sends its officials to Ukraine all the time. So if you're a sovereign country and you know it's a very competitive environment, I mean, we are not talking just about Ukraine. We are talking about security of Ukraine. We are talking about security of Europe, and we are talking about security alliance that's present in Europe, NATO. And that was also a very important consideration that I hope we can discuss.
Yeah, if I can add to that, that's basically one of the three main lines what Russian media are propagating, because Oksana mentioned that she's speaking just for tea and all Russian, other Russian media outlets can give another perspective. It's hardly that. Because now I am researching how Russian media are working very deeply, and I can say that this line of narrative about EU-United States inspired coup in Ukraine is one of the predominant now. And that's kind of very easy explanation, and that's one of three main lines. Another one would be that in Ukraine, because of that US-EU inspired coup, there is a civil war between different parts of Ukraine, and the third line would be that Russia doesn't have any relationship to that. So basically building out a fence between what happened and Russia, and it looks like Russia is just sitting on the fence and looking how the West is trying to divide Ukraine while Ukrainians are struggling between themselves. And it's a very interesting point to explain everything in terms of how West is dividing Ukraine, because that's a very easy explanation. With great interest, I watched your program, your interview with Andrew Kuchins from Center for International and Security Studies, and that's what your main line you promote is through all the program, like, if US would not involve into that, Ukrainians would never come to the street to protest. And you mentioned, and
was never,
yeah, let me finish, please. And you've been referring to famous Victoria fuck EU Newland cookies, and explaining that Ukrainians were out on the street just because of the cookies she was giving out. To be more exact, she was giving out sandwiches, not cookies. But from narrative perspective, cookies are looking much more attractive, because Ukrainians going out to street for cookies really look very attractive as a media target. But it's not about cookies. It's about much bigger things. And Katya already mentioned that a revolution of dignity was about values, first of all. It's not about cookies. And then you go to more interesting passages that, of course, United States would have their own geopolitical interest in Ukraine. So why you would not recognize Russia's interest over there? So let's sit together and negotiate that, sort it out, and decide who is doing what in Ukraine, and there would be no problem at all. So the in other words, if US can be involved and Biden is going to Kyiv, why Russia cannot be a part of this process? And the problem is that US is not a war side now in Ukraine, and Russia is. That's easily explained, the difference, and it's very easy to go to finger pointing and say, yeah, of course it's Biden and Victoria Nuland inspiring all these uprisals, and if they would not be there, all Ukrainians would be sitting at home, not standing on the main square, and been killed in mass, you know, that's all because of the cookies. It's not as easy as that. And when you say that things, it means that you always kind of always simplifying what happening in the country, which is just next border to you, which means that probably you don't know all feelings and all things which happened in Ukraine in the last 20 years, and probably someone overlooked how many things change inside Ukrainian societies that moved Ukrainians first to the streets during the revolution, then to be protesters against annexation of Crimea the next stage, and finally why Ukrainians are now fighting. Because it's an independence war and Ukrainians are struggling for Ukraine's independence. That's a very simple answer.
Okay. I suggest that we give Oksana a chance again to react, and maybe you can elaborate on this sentence. You said that the West nudged the demonstrators towards violence. So what is your evidence for that?
Well, that is actually leading to the comments that I was sort of preparing in my head as I was listening to. You know, the word propaganda hasn't come up yet, but I'm sure we will discuss it. And Russia's contribution to the field of propaganda, both theoretical and I think practical, is the separation between agitation, agitatsiya, and propaganda. Agitation being just the stirring the unrest, propaganda being trying to translate your point of view. Now, I've never said, and I don't think the Russian political analysts or even the Russian leadership believes that it was the West who, as you said, instigated the events in Ukraine. They have grassroots reasons. Nobody is discussing or trying to dispute that. Just as the uprisings in Libya, the uprisings in Syria, the uprisings in Egypt rather, had very strong grassroots reasons. I think what Russia feels cheated and betrayed by the West is that up until recently there was, and you mentioned also that, you know, you feel, it feels almost like Ukraine is this chessboard that Russia and the West are fighting over. This is, I mean, if you look at the American political science theory, you know, that starting from Brzezinski and all the way forward, the issue of Ukraine and its relationship to Russia has always been a main subject of American political discussion when it comes to CIS. I mean, this is undisputable. This has always been there. Now, I'm not saying that, again, Americans are totally responsible for what happened at Maidan, but again, I think there was...
Can you give us a percentage of responsibility?
You cannot assign, even though some American presidents did have a habit of sort of assigning percentages to what role the United States should play, for example, the Security Council. Truman was famous for that, like assigning 80%. I think, some presidents put a different figure, American presidents put a different figure, that I'm not as clever as that. I don't know how to quantify influence. But what I was going to say is that up until last year, there was sort of a gentleman's agreement between Russia and the West about civil rules of trying to influence events in Ukraine. And the agreement was to do that through the ballot box. Surely Russia has people or forces it tries to influence in Ukraine, just as the West, Europe, or the United States. And they always did that up until recently through constitutional means. There was Orange Revolution before that you may argue was against Russia's interest, but Russia went along with that and nothing happened because the will of the people was respected. What was different this time around is that despite the fact that there were elections, you know, the old parties agreed, the European foreign ministers and the Yanukovych government, they agreed on elections that were coming up until the in a couple of months, by the end of the year, some forces at Maidan felt that they still had to push and violently oust the government.
No, he just fled.
Thank you. That's a bit condescending, but thank you nonetheless. I think what Russia felt was where the Europe and the European countries and the United States were cheating, it was betraying their own principles and their own values by putting the very, I think, fragile institutional democracy in Ukraine, because, I mean, it's just as fragile in Russia. I'm not suggesting that we are much advanced on this front, because, I mean, the Soviet Union collapsed just 2 decades ago, so democracy, democracy takes time. But what Russia felt was that for the sake of its political interest, the United States, primarily the United States, I think Europe was on the fence there, didn't do anything to sort of calm tensions down, because by allowing political forces at Maidan, and you cannot claim, as I think Katya claimed a while ago, that every single Ukrainian felt that, you know, that statistically would be impossible. I think they, you know, if you look at any poll, there were people who were not in favor of Russia's political line. No, nobody is talking about that, but in favor of closer cooperation with Russia. You know, the east of the country has a strong industrial sector, so why wouldn't they be? And I think by allowing those forces, who are primarily represented by Western Ukraine and Central Ukraine, to preserve the entire political landscape of Ukraine, and by essentially kicking out forces that represented Eastern Ukraine, that was not only the betrayal of democracy in Ukraine, but it was also aggravation of the tensions that already existed in Europe beforehand.
Thanks. Okay. So we're talking about the next stage in the narrative, which is the ousting of Yanukovych.
No, I get it. The first comment that I was going to make, and I'm quite often speak in panels and all kinds of events in Ukraine and Russia related, that are related, and I'm always amazed at how condescending the Russian view of Ukraine is. You know, how frequently you get a point of view when Ukraine is considered like, you know, this lump meat steak that, you know, the US and Russia somehow carve up. You know, this is your piece and this is your influence, and it's primarily in the West, and this is our sphere of influence, and we make an agreement about how to eat this steak, you know, and you guys are nothing to do with it. And that's the impression that I get. Well, this revolution was actually about sovereign choice for Ukraine. You know, Ukraine, whether you like it or not, whether, you know, people in the east, west, south of Ukraine liked it or not, as a nation, made a step forward and made a choice. Instead of its multi-vector foreign policy, it decided to go for an association agreement with the European Union. And then the nation was betrayed by its own president. But it's a sovereign choice whether we choose to go for the alliance with the European Union or Russia or whatever.
Can I ask you very quickly, what was the problem for Ukrainians to wait a couple of months and make that sovereign choice at the ballot box without actually, you know, violating your own constitution? It wasn't a problem.
Can I get back to my comment?
Okay.
I was about to address that.
Okay, thanks.
So the next myth was about an agreement that was allegedly achieved between representatives of Europe, Russia, and Ukraine. Well, unfortunately, people in the street did not perceive it as a real agreement. That's number one point, but it's not the most important one. The most important point is that while the agreement was signed, there is video footage that shows that for the 2 days prior to that agreement, the president was actually packing his valuables in his out-of-town residents, you know, documents and vases and pictures, packing it all into trucks and shipping it out. And the next morning, after the agreement was signed, he ran away from the country. First, he went to Kharkiv, and then he went to Russia. He ran away from his own people, leaving a lot of people protesting in the streets, leaving, you know, a country without a leader, without an elected leader. And this is where the Russian narrative kicks in, and they say, well, you guys ousted an elected leader. Well, you know what? Our constitution also says that the holder of power in Ukraine is its people. And we have a number of other laws that were able to step in and patch up the missing legislation. And we actually elected an interim government and an interim president, and then went on to have an early election in May, where a new president was elected by an overwhelming majority of Ukrainians.
If I can answer your question why Ukrainians just cannot wait months to elections, for one very simple reason, because almost 100 Ukrainians have been killed on the square by snipers who've been directly shooting in the heads of people just to make sure that everybody who gathered over there to select another public system administrative system and government system for Ukraine, they've been directly killed by snipers. And that's not kind of stability you mentioned at the very beginning that Ukrainians would tolerate, because if this stability means killing unarmed, innocent protesters on the square by sharpshooters, that's not a governance Ukrainians would accept at any point. So there can be no governed democracy supported by snipers. That's not evidently Ukrainian choice, and it did not work this time, and it would not work at any other point in history, and that's not a stability Ukrainians are striving to, and we would never accept this model. And one of Ukrainian previous Ukrainian president, Kuchma, once wrote a book called Ukraine is not Russia. So that's probably a point why Russian journalists cannot understand why it happened in Ukraine, because Ukraine is just not Russia.
But Yevgen, isn't there a point in what Oksana said, that why couldn't the Ukrainians just wait for the elections?
Because and isn't, the president isn't, escaped.
Yeah, he was not there
it's
anymore.
Not easy.
He was in Rostov in Russia.
First of all, let me, if I can add, I think it wasn't the case of President Yanukovych, though I think he was a totally corrupt politician, and I strongly resent the portrayal of him being pro-Russian politician, because if you know anything about the Kremlin politics, he was, well, I wouldn't say detested in the Kremlin, but the tensions between him and Putin were very, very high because of him essentially trying to play off both Russia and the European Union and sort of milking the two cows. But it wasn't the case of him just packing stuff and leaving for vacation.
Oh,
he received death threats, at least that's what he says. And I don't think
he also says he didn't steal anything, but you know.
Well, you are like a Ukrainian journalist committed to macracking. You would know about that. And again, what I said is
Would you agree that Yanukovych was corrupt?
I absolutely believe. I mean, I think everybody believes that both in Russia, well, apparently now in Ukraine, but that doesn't mean, you just talked about democracy and those, you know, aspirational rhetoric. And, you know, I think Russian people are also committed, maybe that would be surprising to the audience, but we are also committed to democracy. We actually want to build a democratic state with free media. Well, again, I think that's a bit condescending on you guys, and that's not a good debate tactic, but nevertheless, I think we all understand that democracy is not beginning but the end. And if you look scientifically at all the, you know, democracy promotion projects around the world, and Russia and Ukraine are not unique here, there are many countries who attempted that. That transition, if you start with public unrest, if you start with violence, your chances of getting to democracy are actually very, very limited. So true, you had your right to, you know, take to the streets. And by the way, what happened actually on Maidan with the snipers is still highly debated. You know, that suspicion's been raised by European diplomats as well. But what I think is important, and where I will contradict with you, you talk about democracy, but you betrayed your own democracy by, I mean, the people of Ukraine at least, and Europeans as well, by sort of acquiescing to that. You decided that Yanukovych was worth, this corrupt politician, as you say, was worth, you know, breaking your own constitution. It wasn't the case of Libya where people, you know, had to wait for decades to do something with Gaddafi. You had elections coming this same year. You know, you could spend time, Ukrainians, I mean, on campaigning, but what you did essentially ostracized and marginalized part of the Ukrainian electorate, and that, I think, that is actually against the spirit of democracy, you know, on many fronts.
Yeah, I was trained as a political scientist, and I can give you one example when people went to the street and built a great democracy, which is French Revolution, for example.
Which resulted in 1 million of deaths. I mean, if you look at the actual
Ukrainian history, unfortunately, also already resulted.
You give it as a positive example.
Yeah, let me finish, please. And Ukrainian, this piece of history also already ended up with 4,000 people killed, most of them by Russian army, which is now is in Ukraine. And this is not as tragic, for example, as a million French you mentioned. For Ukraine, it is tragic because that's 4,000 people who've been alive before, and now because of the military activities and the war, in Ukraine we have a war, and one of the side is another state fighting in Ukraine, and we resulted already in 4,000 people killed, and yeah, that's what we have, and that's kind of dramatic for Ukraine.
Okay.
Yeah, can I make
yes,
a comment?
Please.
Yeah. I know that there is a danger that a revolution might not lead quite to the type of democratic development that we would like to see in Ukraine. That is a danger, but there is a chance that it will, and the Ukrainians have decided to take that chance.
But nobody
That's
was
not, can I
taking
finish
that
my point?
Chance
I,
from them.
I did not interrupt you when you spoke. Can I finish my points, please? Number two point is that Ukrainians, in fact, observed their own constitution, because the constitution explicitly says that the power belongs to people, and people have the right to elect and re-elect presidents. And this is why we have elections, more frequently than the Russians like them, obviously, but we like them this way, and it's our choice whether to have them or not. And I was also going to comment about the Western versus Russian involvement in Ukraine's Maidan, which is, it's an interesting comment, again, to hear from the Russian side, because there's absolutely no evidence of the West being a part of the strategy forming team in the presence in a circle. But there is plenty of evidence of infiltration of Russian special services, that our SBU, secret service chief was a Russian agent, that the operation to suppress Maidan was partly planned by Russian operatives who were working with our president in the last stages. And those investigations are yet to come out, and they are being investigated. But as far as I understand, there are no such things that are related to what the Russian narrative likes to portray as an American influence.
A shortcut reaction to that?
Well, it would be difficult to make it short, but I'll try my best. I'm just trying to decide in my head which point to pick up on. I think when we are talking about the Russian reaction here, again, Russian reaction is not so much with the trajectory of Ukraine's development, especially political development. You want to be associated with the West, that's fine. I mean, that has been sort of the movement of Ukraine over the past couple of years. I mean, starting with Yushchenko and then Yanukovych. I mean, in the beginning of his term, Yanukovych wasn't the pro-Moscow leader. He was, again, sort of trying to sit on two chairs. What I'm concerned about as a former war reporter, and what I think the Kremlin saw in this whole thing, is, again, the effort on the part of some people within the Ukrainian political elite is to rock the boat and take people to the streets. Now, you can say that democracy belongs to the people, we all agree with that, but I think the assessment of that could be made at the ballot box when you make the head count and you actually know what people think. Making those assessments on the streets, which has been the Western sort of policy of the past couple of years, again, in Tahrir, in Benghazi, in Dara, in Syria, that's a very imprecise assessment, and you can always find in any crowd, you can find people who support one perspective, and you can find people who support something totally different. So the point, I think, for the Kremlin, the point that I'm trying to advance here is that if you're committed to democracy, there was absolutely no way, well, I mean, Ukrainians could decide for themselves, but what I think spoiled significantly Russian relations with the West is that, especially Europeans, that Europeans didn't stand up and said that, come on guys, just calm down, we don't need another potential conflict in the middle of Europe, just calm down again. There was an agreement on early elections coming up by the end of the year. Europeans could have done something to not only pacify the situation, but allowed it to take a more European course rather than, again, reverting into that path of, you know, people's revolutions and dignity. I mean, come on, that's just rhetoric. Everybody wants dignity, but people in Benghazi, I was there in Benghazi when people demanded dignity. Do they have it now? Do they have? That's a great danger. I mean, just destroying the whole country and facilitating the death of so many, hundreds of thousands of people in the Middle East have been killed because of those pursuits. There's an alternative way. Why is it so difficult for Europe to just wait a little bit? It would get to its course anyway.
Can I take that question?
Yeah, I would really like to move on to the next stage, please.
Well, another danger is to substitute notions in a debate. And this is exactly what you're doing time in and time out. Because Ukraine's situation is pretty unique, and you cannot make
every parallel. Situation is unique. That
full
was
stop. Mm.
That well,
and
you agree.
Point number two that I was going to make, I totally agree about the ballot box, and this is exactly why Ukraine just had two elections.
And very short remark about your. I totally hate to disagree with you this evening, but when you say that Kremlin would not be opposing any movement of Ukraine towards EU or NATO. It's also just you.
I didn't say NATO, I said EU. That's quite a difference.
Yeah, well, so I would just support it with the last week conversation between President Putin and President Poroshenko, phone conversation, where Putin put it very bluntly. If Ukraine is moving any closer to EU or NATO, we are storming Mariupol and taking the rest of the way of Ukraine up, down
can
to
Crimea. Can you give me the transcript of that statement? I've never heard it.
Yeah, I would be all interested to discuss transcripts a little bit later, but I just give the audience the idea
heard it, I'm a,
how Kremlin is not interested at all in where Ukraine belongs.
Speaking about stopfake.org, I mean, can we have the source before we move any further? I think that's important.
Yeah, I don't think this is a fake. That's why I am offering this here. But
maybe we can clarify this later. So this is a little bit difficult right now. I would like to move on to the next stage, which is the annexation of the Crimea. So what is, in your view, the rationale behind this? Why had the Crimea to be annexed by Russia?
Well, I think there are two issues that you have to consider, sort of two parallels in this whole thing. First of all, the historic status of Crimea. And I don't think it is very straightforward. I think if you check the literature of, for example, people who participated in the negotiations between Yeltsin and Kravchuk at the time of the breakup of the Soviet Union, there was always an understanding that Russia will have access to the Black Sea. It wasn't so much about Crimea per se, even though, you know, as a land that has a dramatic significance for Russians, because, I mean, according to various estimates, between 400,000 and 800,000 Russian people lost their lives there, you know, trying to get access to the Black Sea. But I think there was an understanding on the part of all Ukrainian administrations since independence that Russia will always be having access to the Black Sea. If that issue was ever raised, I think the status of Crimea would have come up earlier. Now, what was different about Maidan revolution is that for the first time we had not only forces on the streets articulating the desire to kick out Russians out of Crimea, but also those forces coming to power. And the manner in which those forces came to power also helped that whole event transpire, because from the Russian point of view, as I think I articulated, the change of power in Kyiv was not only unconstitutional, but it was done in a way to suppress any political force in Ukraine that would be in favor of, you know, closer ties in Russia, and that would be in favor of Russians' continued presence in Crimea. And in response to that, I think Putin, as I think with any other Russian president, felt that it is his historic mission to preserve Russia's access to the Black Sea. I think NATO aspect did play a role, but there is absolutely no way that any, even Yeltsin, that he would just pass on those threats. And just to finish my comment very quickly, I think there was always an understanding also on the part of the Ukrainian leadership that Russians do have special rights to the Crimea. Otherwise, you would have never allowed any other country to station their troops there permanently. So it is a very painful event, I understand, for the Ukrainians. I think it's also a painful event to some extent for Russians. I mean, there is a jubilation, obviously, for across the country because we, you know, that's a very galvanizing historic event. But I think we all understand that by getting Crimea, we lost the goodwill of many Ukrainians, and that's painful. But I think the hope, both within the political circles and within the population as a whole, that somehow these ties could be mended. I mean, there are various options that are being discussed within the Moscow rumor mill, starting from making it sort of a common economic zone where both Russian and the Ukrainian businesses will operate. You know, if you believe in the idea of the European integration, it wouldn't matter that, you know, where the lines are drawn. But for the time being, I do think that I sense your skepticism, and I do think that this is a major hurdle in our political relations. But I think Ukraine's, and especially some, I would say, political forces on the part of Ukraine who made those irresponsible statements are partially responsible for those events, because I mean, if you look at the statements coming from Putin over the past couple of years, it was always clear that Russia will never allow anyone to push it out of the, you know, to limit its access to the Black Sea.
If I can answer it very shortly, in international relations, we don't have a concept of painful, because it comes out from emotional things, and international relations are about facts. And international relations are about international law, is about territorial integrity of sovereign states.
Not always.
So, yeah, as we can see, it's not always. So, basically,
that was not the first instance.
If someone feel painful, he or she can go and grab someone else's purse, computer, or a piece of land, a piece of a country, just because you feel painful.
Well, when I was saying painful, I alluded to Ukrainians. I don't think Russians feel painful on that front.
Yeah, I think
jubilant.
You understand what I mean. And so it's about core principles. So what is the victim of this, even not Ukraine, chunk of which just departed in unknown direction, but that's now the problem of Crimea. We cannot solve it because it's up to Russia now what to do with it. But it's an insult to the whole system of international relations. And we are sitting in the place where for century people have been trained to how to do international relations. And this principle of sovereignty of the state was an integral part of the theory and practice of international relations. So if one country start to move that system, the whole domino would fall, you know. And when we, you know, talk about, you mentioned that it was kind of urgent reaction from Putin because you know what forces came to power in Ukraine. I would give you a very human story from Crimea. There was a rabbi, Misha Kapustin, in Simferopol, who was interviewed by RT and asked how, after Russia occupied Crimea, how he's feeling about being here. And he said in the interview, yeah, I feel unsafe now because I have children and I need to move from Simferopol now somewhere else. And after Russia occupied Crimea, there were graffitis appeared on the wall, death to Jews. It was in Crimea after Russia occupied it. What Russia today is doing, they're producing a great story that rabbi in Kiev is feeling unsafe and is worried about his kids' safety because of junta, fascist junta, who came to power in Kiev, and they're putting graffiti from Simferopol wall if it happened in Kiev. So the whole story is twisted because now Jews in Kiev feel very unsafe due to junta, fascist junta, who came to power in Ukraine and in Kyiv. So you see how it's, we can easily manipulate very small things. We just change the location of rabbi from one congregation to another, and we have very different story with very, very different meaning. So that's one of the examples. And you mentioned that we talk propaganda, not instigation. Please explain if it's not instigation, if we talk that Jews feel unsafe in Ukraine after the new government came to power. So is it not an instigation for them to pack their stuff and move somewhere else? It is instigation.
Should I?
Maybe you join in if you want to, and then you could reply.
Well, the whole all of the premises of the Russian position on Crimea are so ludicrous that it just makes me sick, to be honest. And it's beyond being painful, because there are a lot of presumptions that simply don't work in international law. I mean, yes, Russia did have a special status in a sense in Crimea, because it had the only foreign military base in Ukraine was based in Crimea. But that was under an international agreement, a valid international agreement signed by both countries. You know, and then Russia's just barged in and took over the whole of peninsula. It's, you know, the Americans have bases all over Europe, 56 bases, for example, or facilities that they use in Germany. That's a special relationship between Germany and America. Does that mean that America should presume that it can annex a part of the German territory? No. And if you're talking about, provinces with complex histories, we're talking about the whole of Europe. There's not been a single border in Europe that has not changed over the past few hundred years. Does that mean that countries have the right to barge in and take parts of other countries' territories? No, it doesn't, because we live under a set of international laws, under a security system that was established after the Second World War, and we are a part of that system. And undermining that system is very dangerous, because we have no idea what the consequences are going to be. It's a very, very scary thought, and that's exactly what Russia is doing and what it did in Crimea. Naturally, it hasn't, the consequences have not quite rolled as far as Europe, and a lot of people in Europe still do feel safe, but not all. You know, just recently, the president of one of the Baltic countries has basically stopped short of calling Russia a state sponsor of terrorism, a terrorist state, basically, for this and other reasons. And she has very good reasons to do that, and Crimea was just a first step of many that displayed such behavior.
Well, you both talked about the international law, and I, in general terms, agree with you. You called what happened in Crimea an insult to the international system, and if I had to side with your opinion, I also have to add that the international law has been insulted pretty often over the past few years. Now, primarily by the United States, by invading Iraq, again overstepping its mandate in Libya, doing what it did to Syria. Now, does it excuse Russia? I mean, there are various opinions about whether Russia was acting within the confines of the law. And
but do you accept that Russia has violated international law in the Crimea? As you've mentioned examples where the international law has been breached.
I think in legalistic terms, if you really want to follow the letter of the law, I think Russia perhaps has a case, because I don't know if you know that, but the international borders of Ukraine, the border between Ukraine and Russia, has not been properly demarcated after the collapse of the Soviet Union.
And it's that, not for lack of our trying, guys.
Well, I mean, it doesn't matter. I mean, we are talking about the letter of the law. I'm talking about legalese. Now, if you talk about the spirit of the law, perhaps that's a more complicated issue. But I think what I'm leading to here is that, you know, there is a saying in Russia, if you are together with the wolves, you have to howl as a wolf. And I think you cannot expect Russia to be the only country to comply with the international law. And when the West sees the international law supposedly being broken by Russia, I hope that will encourage other countries, the West, China, Iran, to comply, to come up with their uniform interpretation of the international law. So we know whenever something happens in any country, we interpret that uniformly, because up until recently, the international law has been, twisted and turned to accommodate Western interests. Not like to accommodate Western interests with very dubious consequences for the West as well. I think that happened again in Iraq, in Libya, to some extent in Syria. Does it justify Russia doing so? Perhaps not. But I think one of the consequences is the need to redesign the international system so that everyone, not just Russia, the United States, bargain over spheres of influence, but every single country, no matter how big or how small, feels that it has the rules of engagement that everybody would comply with. Because in a situation, in the global situation, when you can sort of favor the sovereignty at one point, but then favor the right of people to self-determination at other point, I don't think that's very, very helpful and very, very respectful of that system as a whole.
So basically what you describe is already kind of, there is a term coined, it's called whataboutism. So Russia is explaining now everything with whataboutism. Yes, we did it, but look, others are doing that as well. So is that a new premise for international law? Mm. Yeah, you keep repeating it all the time that US did that in Iraq, in Libya, in Syria, and Afghanistan. So it's called whataboutism.
Yeah, it's a very common fallacy.
Is whataboutism a kind of a core of new legalistic international system now? So if I do this, you can do that? That's a law?
I hope that is not the law. That's why.
Yeah, but
that's
why that's okay.
No, I'm
if
not.
Others are doing
that I don't think it justifies Russia. I say that I myself have qualms with the international fallout of the Crimean affair. I do, but I don't think there is any other way. Well, I mean, I don't think Putin actually was thinking about international law at that point of time. I think he was thinking about the Russian national interest and the fact that there is very little respect to international law, primarily from its main upholders, from its main advocates being the United States. You cannot expect Putin to, be the only protector of it. I think Russia did try its best in Syria, trying to explain the international community that it's simply not helpful of coming and trying to change countries as you perhaps, driven by very good, noble aspirations as you want them to be changed. And this time around, it happened closely, much closer to Russian border. And again, as I said, I don't think any other Russian president would have reacted differently. I mean, there was no point from my perspective, and I am cosmopolitan, I'm an internationalist, I was educated in the United States. I do want Russia to be, as I said, a democracy. I do want Russia to develop grassroots society, free media, free discourse. And I think we still have lots of room for improvement. I'm not under any illusion here. But from my perspective, the only, putting Russia into the corner is not the best way of doing that, because we have lots of national sensibilities. I think Russians and Ukrainians do have a lot in common in the way they react to violence, in the way they conduct discourse. I think that's been evident even in this discussion. We are more emotional. We are not like Austrians. We cannot be reserved, or we cannot control our emotions properly. I think that's very common of our people. And
everybody,
we all have mixed
the
ethnicity here. So I think, okay. Should I stop there?
No, it's wonderful.
Okay,
I just want to raise one issue, and then I would like to open up the floor for questions. The last point would lead me to Eastern Ukraine. So, and I would like to repeat one remark Oksana has made at the very beginning and ask you, isn't there something to it that the Ukrainian government contributed to the current situation by alienating Eastern Ukraine or parts of the elite in Eastern Ukraine? Did the government contribute to this current crisis situation there?
Yeah, the government of Yanukovych was pretty much consisting of elites from Eastern Ukraine. And basically those are the same elites who made a lot of money and robbed their own provinces.
I was talking about the new elite. Yeah.
Yes,
yeah.
No, I understand. But there is a historic context to it. I do believe that the current government is not nearly doing enough to engage the Eastern Ukraine. I think that they have done it they've done too little too late. But at the same time, I think that the situation wouldn't nearly be as grave and dramatic as it is now had it not been for the Russian involvement. Because, you know, basically the war is there between Russia and Ukraine. And the war is between Russian-sponsored terrorists who provide, you know, weapons, ammunition, supplies, money, mercenaries to Eastern Ukraine against the Ukrainian army and the Ukrainian volunteers. And the Ukrainian army, on top of that, is being crowdsourced. We basically, you know, crowdsource on the websites and the social networks, the clothes, the ammunition, and provisions for the army because it's been looted for so long and so on and so forth. But that's a different issue, I guess.
Yeah, and I can add that if Russian propaganda would not be involved in instigating people in the East, the events would develop in quite different way. There are many, many dramatic stories because Russian television and other media are widely accessible for the people in the East and widely popular over there. People are consuming a lot of Russian programming, very different, not only news and current affairs, but a lot of entertainment. And in Russian media, propaganda is included in every type of content television can provide. And people really were instigated at different stages of the conflict by very unified position by different Russian media outlets. And I can give you two examples, one quite dramatic and one funny. Dramatic would be Russian media, of course, state-controlled and state-owned, are reporting that Ukraine is switching from Cyrillic alphabet to Latin alphabet. And they are not quoting any source, just saying that unknown source in Parliament of Ukraine just reported that. And it was in the morning. By the end of the day, there was a huge demonstration in Kharkiv, in the east of Ukraine, protesting against this. So you can see the relationship between what Russian media produce in the morning and what Ukraine has by the end of the day. And another example is a funny one. It's actually the recent example of the propaganda. We would not even be debunking it because it's impossible to debunk. The first TV channel, of Russian TV channel, reported that all those who are enlisted in Ukrainian National Guard for their service are entitled to receive the plot of land in the east of Ukraine, and now attention, two slaves each from the local population. So if you want to get two slaves, you can still enlist into Ukraine National Guard, and of course you would receive a plot of land, so time is ticking off, and we should always should be, you know, hurry. And it's kind of ridiculous, and it looks ridiculous, and it is ridiculous, but you can imagine the kind of perception of the local population if they are fed stories like that, pretending to be news, by the way, because they are usually in the news programming, and if they are fed that 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, you can imagine in what state of political conscious and disaster and stress they might be. So that's kind of a big influence playing over there, and Russian media is much bigger player over there compared even to Ukrainian government.
Well, I mean, I have to take your word for it about this report about slaves. That sounds very unlikely to me. I haven't seen it for one. Now, I do think that the quality of Russian journalism could be substantially improved, just as the quality of Ukrainian journalism and the quality of the Western journalism. I think when you talk about broadcasting, especially when you talk about, well, I'm speaking about from my own experience, not necessarily on Ukraine, because I wasn't a reporter on the ground in Ukraine. I've been there for a couple of interviews, but I wasn't the reporter in the field. But when you, like I speak from my experience in other war zones, you don't have time to fact check every single thing. And that is not an excuse for having inaccuracies. That is certainly not an excuse for a report that you just cited. I mean, like, that sounds preposterous. And if Channel One did it, you know, I suggest that Ukraine pursues them in some sort of court. I mean, please take the initiative and go to Russian court and sue them for libel, because that's certainly what is happening. And I think that will help to improve the standards of journalism in Russia and perhaps, you know, our system, legal system as well, because that would put international spotlight on that. Now, when you talk about Russian media being so influential in the east of Ukraine, well, let us not forget that I think people there are also exposed to the Ukrainian media, and I think there have been a lot of myths on both sides. I think what you're doing is an important job debunking some of them, pointing out inaccuracies, but I think you would be very hard-pressed to debunk the main content that we see streaming from Eastern Ukraine, that is about people being killed, about people, pensioners, babushkas, Ukrainian babushkas who worked their entire life for the country, you know, for that land. Not, it wasn't the country all the time, but, you know, their meager pensions have been cut out by the Ukrainian government. It doesn't pay them at all. And I want to give you one comparison. Gaddafi government, which is very reviled. I mean, he's just devil incarnate. He was paying people in Benghazi up until the very day he was ousted in out of Tripoli. So that gives you a sort of comparison. If you think that they're your people, you have to support them through that difficult moment. So I think you would be very hard pressed to debunk the stories about suffering, debunk the stories, not only Russian channel stories, but, you know, human rights stories about the use of heavy bombing, about the use of cluster bombs, about the alleged use at this point of phosphorus bombs, and so on and so forth. When you, you know, I think Russians, I mean, the Russian political commentators, at least, I'm not sure the Kremlin, but, you know, they accept that the Russian act in Ukraine wasn't the best. I think in these circumstances, you cannot, there are no winners. I mean, we all losers. I agree with that. But I think before debunking or while debunking Russian myths, you also have to pay attention to yourself and the actions of your own government, which is acting quite inhumanely against its own population. And by doing that, exacerbates or helps the scary Russian propaganda to do the job that it initiated, according to you at least.
So do Ukrainian media have a tendency to turn a blind eye to indiscriminate bombing, to human rights violations on the
use
on the Ukrainian side?
Prohibited weapons.
We were one of the first newspapers in Ukraine to write about indiscriminate shellings and things like that in eastern Ukraine. And in fact, our coverage has been of the first the revolution and then the war has been so good that the Kiev Post was the first newspaper in Ukraine's history to win an extremely valuable and extremely you know, highly valued professional award from the University of Missouri in the United States. It's not quite the Pulitzer, but, you know, the Pulitzer is only given to the Americans, but it's an international award and we won it for excellence and our performance. So I think that accusing the Ukrainian media, at least in our case, is totally unfair because we have been reporting things on the other side. What makes us different from the Russian media, however, is that we point out the flaws of our own government as well. And we point, you know, we call black things black and white things white. And we also talk about the gray stuff in the middle. And that's not what you get from the Russian side, because the Russians have never admitted that their own troops have walked into our country. You know, Putin did admit that this happened in Crimea, but post factum, after Crimea was already annexed. And now we're saying exact same thing happening in eastern Ukraine, when the Russian troops are rolling in, when the Russian tanks are rolling in, when the Russian book missiles are moving in and even shooting down planes from the sky. And that's something that affected the whole of Europe and the whole world extremely deeply and profoundly. But the Russian media are slanting the coverage and not only not trying to get to the truth, but actually creating myths and creating flair around that coverage by Ukrainian and international media to confuse the world and to basically lie about what's happening there.
Just for you to understand, in Ukraine there is no one media system which works under the directions from someone, if it's a government or any other institution who develops the policy how media should cover it. in Ukraine we have very pluralistic media, very different media, very different journalists, and journalists in Ukraine can write whatever they want, whatever they feel, whatever they found as facts, and they would not be prosecuted or killed or put in jail. And it was not Ukraine where Magnitsky case happened when he was trying to investigate and what happened to him. So in Ukraine we have pluralistic society, and which we start with Maidan story, and we start to have more and more pluralistic media that are covering all scenes related to government, covering very carefully, looking at everything government and president and parliament are doing, criticizing that. And one of the latest example, when there was a 1 year anniversary of Maidan killing of 100 people, President Poroshenko came up to the relatives of those killed, and relatives been chanting disgrace because the killing was not properly investigated. And all Russian media showed that. Can you imagine that in Russia, that media would cover live how people are chanting disgrace to President Putin?
Well, if people are chanting, absolutely. And I want to remind you that it was just a couple of years ago. It is coming up in December, the anniversary of the protest against Putin in 2011, 2012. There was a strong movement, taking over Moscow, some other bigger cities, and it was all over Russian media. And those people, you know, were not there praising him. I mean, they. And I think Russians could be quite unrestrained when it comes to their political opinions. So, you know, bloody Putin regime is just the easiest characterization. Now, when you say that the Russian media landscape is so uniform, I think you are perhaps misguided. I mean, I don't want to say that you're lying, but anyway, if you look at the figures of openly oppositional stations like Radio Echo Moskvy or TV Rain, their figures have increased during this crisis several times over. They are some of the most popular stations. Well, not some of the most popular stations, but they have very significant audience. On the top of that, I heard you say in the previous, appearances that a third of audience for your own project comes from Russia. Yes. You know, Russians have families in Ukraine. You know, they talk over Skype. So suggesting that the Russian population is, zombies who are following Putin, I think you have to give us a bit more credit. I mean, there are a lot of people who are, Euronews, for example, is very, very widely available in Russian in many cities, primarily bigger cities, cities that tend to be more politically active. Now, am I saying that we are just the world leader on media freedoms? No, I think there are a lot of issues that you will also have to address because old habits die hard. And it's not because of Putin. I mean, I resent this idea of making him this omnipotent figure that sort of decides everything in Russia. He's just a human. I mean, like people that work for government on station can disagree with him on many things, and we can talk about that later. But I think when you guys accuse us, you should check yourself. I mean,
Check. You were talking about TV Rain. That's the TV. That's exactly the TV station that was kicked out of all the cable networks in Russia. You're talking about plurality, but the Russians have just passed a law that does not allow foreigners to own foreign media in Russia. The forcing Sonoma and a whole bunch of other media to close down.
You are misquoting the law. The share that foreigners are allowed to have has been decreased, but it doesn't mean that they are not allowed to be present there. I mean, NTV of all, like, I detest NTV. This is a very sensational Russian channel, but it is run by foreigners. I mean, they have a couple of guys in the upper management who are foreigners, who are Americans, in fact. So, okay.
I would like you're wonderful. I want to leave it there and give you the opportunity to ask questions. I guess there are some people here in the audience who want to ask. Yeah. Please identify yourself and please no speeches, just shortcut.
Thank you very much, Krauchenberg. I just wonder about this Budapest memorandum, because yes, I think it was signed in 94, and Ukraine gave up its atomic weapons, and it was guaranteed by Russia, US and UK, that the borders would be recognized fully and a political and economic independence of Ukraine, which it had for 20 years now.
Okay, so this was just a statement, okay. Please.
Hello, I'm still Peter from Hungary. So I was wondering if you could comment whether you think the plan European Eurasian Economic Union, which is due to start in January, had anything to do with the things happened in Ukraine.
Okay, so maybe we take these two questions: statement, Budapest Memorandum, and EU Association Agreement. Yeah. Who wants to start?
Yeah, probably yeah. I can give you the idea what is the feeling in Ukraine about Budapest Memorandum. So Ukrainians feeling very much betrayed, including by the US, which you mentioned like is a big puppeteering force behind Ukraine.
You're mischaracterizing what I said. But
That's what I presume from what you said.
That's it.
As is my right. And
about what I said, you mean?
So Ukrainians feel betrayed by international community. And because you're right, that was kind of international obligation to preserve Ukrainian territorial integrity and guarantee it, because Ukraine get rid of its nuclear weapon. So now in Ukraine, there is a strong feeling that Ukraine was betrayed. And that's again a kind of not very assuring for international system in general, because it gives a doubt to many other international agreements you have around, which were supposed to preserve existing system, but rather this agreement doesn't have any value besides the paper it's written on. So what's the value of the agreement if no part of this agreement is trying to oblige what is written over there? And the second issue which this process started in Ukraine, and we are very deeply indebted to Russia and to President Putin for this, a huge boost in pro-European and pro-NATO feelings and rhetorics. And if you would compare polls taken 1 year ago and taken now, you would see the huge increase in public sentiment towards more close, very close EU integration, NATO integration, and one very important, not international, but domestic scene, that it really boosted Ukrainian national identity through the whole Ukraine. If before that, Russian media could easily play the game East versus West, play language issues, religious issues, ethnic issues, and all other things. Now they are basically all gone because of the external aggression towards Ukraine, and Ukraine now is defending itself. And it's really a huge feeling inside Ukraine, unifying feeling, which comes across all the regions. And with these moves, Russia finally started the huge push towards the creation of national identity of Ukraine, because in 1991, Ukraine was given independence. And it's very different compared when you struggle for your independence. And of course, all the scenes, Maidan, Crimea, and the war, Russian-Ukraine war in the East, created the huge pantheon of heroes, which would be the new pantheon of heroes for Ukrainian history. And now Russia is quite, you know, feeling losing Ukrainian ground, and it's quite explainable, because if you push Ukraine, kick Ukraine, invade Ukraine, you can expect that anti-Russian sentiment or pro-Ukrainian sentiment would go up. And it doesn't relate it to the external factors like, again, EU or NATO, but there is kind of growth over there, but it's huge unifying force inside Ukraine. And what we call this war is a war for independence happening now in Ukraine.
Do I need to
pick? Yeah, do you want to?
Well, I would agree with you on the your first statement about the Bucharest Treaty, I think it supports my own thesis that the international law in its many forms is not being respected. And I think we need perhaps not a new system, but we need a firm agreement among international partners that, you know, this means this, no matter what. The aggression against people, you know, the use of heavy artillery against civilians, whether it is in Syria or in Ukraine, means the same thing, it's aggression. Or, for example, people, you know, attacking police stations or, you know, killing journalists, it also means terrorism. You know, not only when it happens, for example, in Afghanistan or Iraq, but also when it happens in Syria. I think we do need a clarity on that and many other issues. Now, what you said about this pro-European and anti-Russian sentiment, I agree with you as a matter of reality. I don't think you can, though, build national identity on hatred. And I think that sentiment is very much motivated by Russophobic feelings. Now, Katya mentioned earlier that the Ukrainian case is unique. And believe me, every country believes, every person believes that about himself. But we saw the same thing happening again in Libya and Syria just 3 years ago, when people felt, you know, they were unified by hatred against Gaddafi or against their leaders. And then when I was in, for example, in Libya, many people were telling me, you know, look, we have the same amount of oil in Dubai. Why aren't we not living like that? We just kick out, you know, Gaddafi and the next day it will happen. Now, certainly the democracy building project takes time, and it is just as likely to get worse as it is likely to get better. I do hope, though, that Ukrainians will prove us wrong, that they will serve as an inspiration for all of us. But I do think that, you know, this level of enthusiasm is not sustainable, at least if it's based on Russia bashing, which I think is a big fuel for your political debate. I mean, if you, I do expose myself on purpose, but, you know, that's part of my job to Ukrainian media. And I think it is very, very much present, and it could be dangerous for your own country. And I think that's the last thing I'm going to say. The measure of propaganda within the national media landscape would be the leader's freedom in changing their policies. Because for Putin, you know, you mentioned, you know, Russians being brainwashed. Putin wouldn't be difficult to, you know, change his course slightly and cooperate with the Ukrainian government. He's doing that already. Would it be so easy for the current Ukrainian authorities to change the course and be cooperative with Russia? Because you will have to, you know, at least on the economic front, given that there are, you know, 3-4 million Ukrainians working in Russia currently, people who are sending money to their families. I mean, they have jobs, they, you know, their businesses. So unless you want to go completely, you know, cut those ties completely, if that happens, that may be your choice. But I think that would also inevitably lead to social consequences, you know, the rise of unemployment and the struggling between the people. And all indications are that there is, you know, a communication between Putin and Poroshenko. Poroshenko is, many analysts in Moscow agree, is an agreeable figure for Moscow. They're ready to negotiate with him. They're ready to come to some sort of reconciliation. But I'm not sure that reconciliation is possible within that current of, you know, national sentiment that you just mentioned. You highlighted one part of it, which is a very propagandistic term. I mean, you know, highlighting one part of the problem and omitting the other. Yes, it is pro-European. It is unifying, but it is also based on hatred, which is, no, at the end of the day,
no, I'll have to chip in here, mm-hmm, actually. I think that this is a dangerous view coming from the Russian propaganda.
All views coming from Russia, yeah, are dangerous. I mean, that's the, yeah, start of this discussion.
No, you're twisting what I just said. I'm saying that this particular notion of our national identity being based on hatred and Russophobia is very dangerous, because it's totally not. In fact, Ukrainians have traditionally and always have thought that Russians are our biggest friend, are our brotherly nation, you know, the Slavic Brotherhood and everything. But it wasn't Ukraine that annexed a part of your territory. It was you guys. You marched in and took a part of our territory. You sent in tanks, you continue to send in mercenaries, you continue to finance terrorism in the East, and you continue to fail to observe any agreements that the Ukrainian government is trying to reach. In fact, when our president came to power, the first thing he did is he stopped the he stopped the fire and started ceasefire unilaterally. It didn't stop from the other side. It continued from the Russian side to Ukraine's territory.
We'd really like to answer the question from Peter
yes, about the Eurasian Union. I think this type of behavior and this type of rhetoric from Russia make sure that fewer and fewer countries would be willing to participate in the Union, where only one player is dominating. And we saw very painful reaction from Kazakhstan, who is not that much sure if they still want to pursue that. And very painful reaction again from Belarus. They are not sure again what their role in that be. And I would just give you a very short quote from the comment from Oksana's program on Ukraine. That's a user-generated content from comment section, which describe how people are feeling what Kremlin should be doing. It would be great to see Kremlin take much harder stance against these lying criminals instead of throwing them a lifeline with a gas deal. Winter is when we have the greatest strategic advantage, and it would be our own benefit to apply maximum pressure on Kyiv and EU in order to collapse the floor from under their feet. So if you feel this is a good approach to building unions, you are absolutely have right impression why countries are willing to join in with each other,
Evgeny,
in the union.
You dedicate a lot of effort to debunking Russia propaganda, but you're using, again, all the tricks in the book. You just said that it was a comment, you know, and then you generalized it not only to me and my program, but the entire Russian Federation. I mean, there are a lot of people in Russia who have nationalist and extreme views. There are some people. I mean, that's what the conflict in Ukraine generated, and I'm very concerned about that. But there are also a lot of other people who believe that we need to come to some sort of accommodation with the Ukrainians, not only, you know, on the current issue of the war in the East, but also on the issue of Crimea. I mean, there is the whole spectrum of opinions on Ukraine and Russia. So why do you represent, you just did it, why do you represent one extreme opinion for the entirety of Russia? And this is a trend that we've been, as you know, Russia's propaganda bullhorn, me representing RT here, we've been fighting all along. I mean, don't reduce Russia to just one set of opinions, even if that's an opinion of Mr. Putin. There is quite a range of views in Russia. We do have a tradition, and you would know that from the Soviet times, of presenting the authorities, of you know, siding with them on one thing, you know, siding them, not siding with them on the other thing. Russians are also prone to outbursts of violence, as was demonstrated in the Russian Revolution. So I think you also have to give us some credit. I mean, I know that you are inspired by great democratic ideas and Jeffersonian democracy. Again, we are also trying to move there. We are just taking the other part.
Thank you. Time is running out. I want to take, there are a lot of questions left. I would like to take all of them, but please keep them short. And I would suggest direct your questions to one of the persons here, and then we can move on quicker. Yeah, the gentleman here, and then you, yeah.
Thank you, yes. I'd like to direct my question to Ms. Boyko. You referred to, yes, Putin as not the only voice. I'd like to ask you what the role of oligarchs have been and what the impact then of EU sanctions are on the whole story.
Well, those are two completely different questions. I think the role of oligarchy in Russia is still significant. I mean, Putin is certainly not the only one like sitting in this, tower, marble tower, who is taking decisions. He is influenced by, you know, both business considerations and, you know, other considerations of Russian elites. I think where the situation in Russia is different from Ukraine is that he himself, earlier in his political career, I think it was his first and perhaps the beginning of the second term, that he took a stance in trying to diminish the influence of big business on the Kremlin. And, you know, lots of books are written on that subject. But one thing you can make sure that I think in Russia, the tail is not wagging the dog. I mean, the dog is taking the decisions. You may we may argue about the value or the quality of those decisions, but I think there is power within the executive. Now, that, I think, is a different case within the Ukrainian societies, but I'm sure Ukrainian colleagues will be able to address that further. Now, the sanctions, well, I mean, obviously, I think they have some effect. I think the fall in the oil price perhaps has a more dramatic effect. Do I like it? No, of course not. But at the time being, my sense, and I'm not a historian, even though I, you know, I've been a student of history and political science, I do think that Russian people, as Henry Kissinger once said, are very resilient. By the way, I think that the Ukrainian people are also very resilient, and that gives me a great hope that the events in Ukraine will not go down the path of what happened in Libya or in Syria, that you guys will be able to hold your society together. I'm genuinely hopeful.
Thank you for your concern. We'll try really hard.
Okay. I don't think you should ironic about that.
No, but this is very ironic. I mean, you're making a parallel that's completely invalid. And you know, our executive, and you know, throwing in jabs that are diminishing us as a nation.
Comparing Ukrainians to Syrians are diminishing?
In a different instance. You were just insulting our whole executive government. Well, actually, yes.
It's not influenced by the oligarchy?
You were not talking about the oligarchy. You were talking about decision making, and there is a decision making process in Ukraine. It's just different. It's pluralistic, and we also delegate power to the elected
your government
officials.
Just came to power.
I guess both of you made your points.
Okay, my name is Mirek. I'm from Slovakia. Question for Mrs. Boyko: aren't you concerned if we are talking about hate? About connection between Russia and ultra-right parties in Europe, because all we know that parties like Jobbik, like UKIP, like Le Pen, they are supported by Russia. They are supported by their money. They are going to observe these fake elections in Crimea and in Donbas, and these people we are talking about, these Jobbik people, and they really hate people like Jewish people. They really hate people like Roma people. So aren't you afraid that from Russia? These two sides, they are really like friends because they are the biggest admirers of Putin. Aren't you concerned about this growing ultra-nationalism?
Well, I'm, of course, concerned about the growth of any extremism, whether it is in Europe, in the Middle East, or in Russia. I think we also have lots of issues on that front. Now, what you just said, I think, is a typical Ukrainian tactic of sort of stripping people in those countries of the agency. You know, what we hear from the Ukrainians is that, you know, those people in the East, they are all just terrorists paid by Russia. There is absolutely no pro-Russian sentiment. What you are saying here, again,
when
is
did
that,
we say that?
Well, I think the...
When did we say that?
Earlier in the discussion.
No, we did not.
You specifically said that the Ukrainian army is fighting against terrorists sponsored by Russia. There are quite a few local volunteers there. I'm not ready.
Volunteers is not the word I would use for paid people.
Well, I mean.
But yes, there are volunteers. I did not say it was exclusively Russian troops, did I?
Well, you didn't say. You didn't say about the Russian troops at all. I didn't say that. I mean, but well, can I finish the question? Because I think there are so many possibilities to go on a tangent here. I do think the extremism of any sort, especially political extremism, is extremely dangerous, especially in the current economic circumstances around the world where a lot of people are under economic stress, and playing that card is extremely dangerous. Putting it all on Putin is not helpful, because usually those attitudes are grassroots, and they tend to exacerbate. Again, there are lots of studies on that in the American academia. Those type of attitudes tend to be more expressed during the economic hardship. So I think Putin, if what you're suggesting, that Putin is somehow flirting with the ultra-nationalist forces, I think he is the first one, and he did it on a number of occasions, to admit that that scenario would be extremely dangerous, not just for Europe. I think Europe is much better on that front than Russia itself. You know, I think Russia itself faces a great danger of extremists coming and being mainstream in politics, being, you know, taking a greater share of the political landscape.
If I can add, so you are saying that Putin is saying that it's a dangerous game with the far right.
Absolutely, yes? Yeah.
And on the other hand, he's giving loans to French far right party.
Well, first of all, I don't think it was Putin who gave it. I think it was some Czech, joint Czech bank. The party that you're referring to is a part, it's not a banned party, it's a party that has had a very great, good showing. I mean, their numbers increased. So as I think the leader of that party just articulated recently, that taking loans from whatever source is not illegal. He's not
including foreign government-related banks.
Well, that's I'm not an expert on the French legislation, but this is what they say. If that's against the law, I hope they pursue that in the court of law, and I do have full confidence in the independence of the French legal system.
Good. I guess we take three more questions. Number one, number two then, yeah?
Okay. Hi, thank you. My name is Yuri. I'm from Austria. I've got ancestors in Ukraine and in Russia, so I can read Ukrainian and Russian newspapers, internet, everything. I don't want to ask a question about these political issues or propaganda because, you know, basically we all know how media works and there's propaganda everywhere. I'd rather ask you as media representatives, how would you, diminish the current, sometimes rather fanatical style of reporting and raise the recognition of more neutral styles of reporting, possibly some of our own journalists from the ORF, for example?
Yes, I mean, we're all striving to
be. I will yield to colleagues because I think I've been talking too much.
So yeah, actually I can start because as soon as I'm representing the project Stop Fake, which is debunking unfair reporting, and that's our main point. So I can say that in 8 months since our launch, we already had more than 300 stories debunked, and most of them would be from media. Some of them would be from Ukrainian media as well. So yes, the reporting of war in the east of Ukraine is absolutely unbalanced. And it is, as Katya already mentioned, unbalanced from both sides. But there is kind of a measurement in this, so we can see. And another scene which is really very important, and thank you very much for this question, because it's a responsibility of journalists for unfair reporting from the war zones. I would give you just one example how unfair and unbalanced reporting, which is basically equals to propaganda and instigating, was leading to genocide in Rwanda. There is a great article published earlier this year in Harvard by David Drotten. You can look it up. So he did very great thing from research point of view. So he wanted to quantify how propaganda increase the number of people killed in Rwanda genocide. So he took two maps, one of the antennas that rebroadcasted the hate radio, RTLN, which was called hate radio because it instigated Hutsi to kill Tutsi. Another map was the number of people killed. And his conclusion was that the number of people killed was the biggest around transmitters who transmitted this instigation, like you should go to the street and kill all those cockroaches. And so his calculation is that 1/10 of all people killed in Rwanda genocide is from 50,000 to 100,000 people were killed due to propaganda activities of journalists and editors. And by the way, many editors from this hate radio of Radio Television du Milcolin were prosecuted by International Criminal Tribunal on Rwanda for their coverage, so-called coverage, and instigating to kill people from other ethnicity. So journalists should recognize the huge responsibility, which not only lies within the values and standards field, what we can discuss inside journalism, but it directly leads to the killing of civilians participating in conflict. And journalists and editors should also remember about responsibility, including the International Criminal Court.
I would like just to add one point. That's not per se to do with journalism, but to do with propaganda. And a lot of the time, especially nowadays, we confuse what the nature of mass media is. We confuse press and propaganda, and that is certainly the case with the Russian media, I feel. You know, because in the whole world, it's a global phenomenon. The amount of money available for the media is going down. While in Russia, for example, where the media is state-owned, the amount of money is going up. And obviously, it's for a reason, because the Russians want their line spread as far out there as they can. You know, the budget of Russia today, for example, is 300 million. Just to give you a perspective, all of Ukrainian television stations spent 800 million last year. So it's more than a third of the total budget of Ukraine's television altogether. And it's set to grow by 41% next year. People here in the audience who are from the media know that this is impossible. It's not a market attitude. And obviously it exists not to inform people, but to pursue a particular policy. You know, it's a part of the foreign policy of the Russian Federation, these media machines. In fact, the budget for the whole propaganda machine is set to grow by 250% next year. And that is something that you just won't ever see in the international media these days. Okay. So cutting down on propaganda would help increase the amount of good coverage, fair coverage, and objective coverage.
Should I respond?
No. No, I'm sorry. But keep it short because time is really running out. I want to take two more questions. Okay. So short reaction, please.
I would agree actually with both of what you said. The goal of RT is partially to make Russian views known. And we make no secret of that. We are called Russia Today. So it's not like we are hiding who is funding us. Now, you just mentioned that you know, without the Russian media, you know, it was much better. I will give you, you gave the example of Rwanda.
No,
I will give you a
propaganda.
Short example of Libya. In the April of 2011, Western media were running away with the story about Viagra that was allegedly distributed to Gaddafi soldiers to enable them to rape local women. And that was, you know, there was a whole controversy about rape being used as a weapon of war, blah, blah. This story was also reinforced by, you mentioned, the International Criminal Court, the Chief Justice, Mr. Luis Moreno Campa. I distinctly remember his press briefing, you know, talking about that. That accidentally happened just a few days, a few weeks before the UN Security Council meeting on Libya that authorized the no-fly zone, the mandate that was then extended to getting rid of Gaddafi and turning Libya into the chaos it is now. What I'm trying to say is not that, you know, Western media were somehow, you know, that the West planted that story. It was later, I mean, there, you know, it's quite, it was established later that the story was concocted by local militia, who, you know, like in one case there was like a man posing as a doctor, then he was posing as a victim. I think we see some of that perhaps in the eastern Ukraine as well. What I'm saying is that it is a very common phenomenon in a war. And I think the only way to prevent that is to have multiplicity of sources. I'm not claiming that RT is the ultimate truth. What we are trying to do on the international arena is to have diversity of opinions. We don't want you to treat RT as the only source. Russians also need to be checked on, just as Ukrainians, just as Iranians, just as Chinese, just as Americans, and just as British. If we have multiplicity of those channels, and we have a lot of them recently, I mean, that's because of the increased funding of state broadcasting, I think the international affairs perhaps, I'm not sure, but perhaps will be a place where different perspectives are considered before wars are launched.
Okay, please, your question.
Good evening, I'm Anastasia from the Diplomatic Academy. I have a question to Mr. Fedchenko. I have actually a comment and a question. The comment is, I just looked up the story about the slaves, and I think it was a little bit taken out of context, because it was a story comparing the situation with the National Army and what Hitler did at the same time, and it was not said by the reporter, but it was a eyewitness report saying that they were in a cellar and he overheard someone saying something. So it's not exactly the Russians saying la 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 slaves in Ukraine. And the question is, you were talking about snipers a lot, And I know that Alexei Yuroshevsky from RT was almost shot sitting in the Ukraine hotel in Maidan Square. So it wasn't only the people who were against the government, but also the journalists shot there. So how can you comment on this?
But was it wasn't
no
shot.
One safe?
You said it wasn't shot.
Well, from what I know from the footage, it almost like flew like two centimeters from his head.
Well, Alexei is a friend of mine, he's a colleague of mine. They were preparing for liver, and the bullet came straight through the window of the hotel room. So obviously, you know, I think what it suggests that bullets were flying all different.
So that's very specific.
Yeah. So my answer would be, you know, almost killed and killed is a little bit kind of a difference in between. And but you are right, here the journalists were also specifically targeted. And probably for those who've been shooting, there was no big difference if it would be a Russian journalist or Ukrainian journalist or Western journalist, because it would make this event even bigger in terms of consequences and impact, because the shooting of protesters had a main objective of having an impact on the situation. It's not only about killing as many people as you can during a specific period of time, but to make an impact and make situation worse and noticed by everybody. And probably that's an explanation why journalists have been targeted. Explaining this constant parallels with Hitler and fascists, that's one of the core lines of Russian propaganda against Ukraine again. Because if you look how Ukrainian government was usually described, it was a Nazi fascist junta. Even though if we would look at the latest elections, we would see that those who belong to far right in Ukraine, who are not, who would not be allegedly fascist, because far right, as you mentioned, in France are not usually fascist, they can be just far right. You know, so we differentiate here between good far right and bad far right, our far right and theirs far right. So our far right is not as bad as you can imagine, and they received 1% during elections. If you would compare that to many other, I would go here into whataboutism. So if you would compare that to many other countries, you would find much more worrying figures about their participation of far right in political life and in the government. And these parallels were specifically aimed to ruin international reputation of Ukraine and to delegitimize it using very specific approaches, like explaining that it's about hate, it's about hatred, ethnic hatred, anti-Semitism. If you would go to Russian propaganda, you would notice that the topic of children was very widely exploited, and you would find hundreds of evidences where the topic of fascism was very widely exploited to the extent where it became just ridiculous, because you cannot find so many fascists and Nazis in one country, even if it's a country of 40 million. So it really looked, it really went beyond the level where the audience would comprehend and accept the situation as based on the facts and based on the facts on the ground. So that's probably the place where Russian propaganda played the bad game with themselves, you know, over exaggerating it. And finally, we have the great news last week, the Jewish Vice Prime Minister was elected to be a speaker of Ukrainian parliament, and Ukrainian social media were, wow, fascist is finally in charge of Ukrainian parliament. Finally it happened. So, you know, you can propagate this sin as far as you want, but if you look at the facts on the ground, you would find many examples when what allegedly is and what really is just not coinciding.
Can I just, one sentence, I want to say it for the record that I don't agree with your portrayal of the Russian media portrayal. I don't think any respectable media uses the term, what you said, Nazi or fascist junta. There may be some extremists on the blogs, yep. They exist in your country as well, but I don't think this is the way neither Russian political establishment nor the Russian people see what is happening in Ukraine.
Yeah, I can give you just one instance when you used personally this term. When you again were spoken to Andrew Kuchins, you asked why we would not call US government fascist. So
But that was the, you know, the question before, because Andrew Kutchins obviously accused Russia of being a fascist state. He said that Russia was on the verge of fascism, and he mentioned several conditions that would justify that. And I think all those conditions apply equally to Russia as to Ukraine, as to the United States.
Like, so everybody is fascist.
Well, that was the question I was asking him, whether he thinks if he believes that Russia is a fascist, that does, you know, apply to the United States as well. And he obviously said no, so I mean, who would be surprised?
The gentleman at the first row, the very last question, because we are in overtime.
Okay, well, I would have a lot of questions, but I will ask for you just a few of them, especially one. To the supporters to of
Pla- the please, please one.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, so I will choose one. The first one is when it comes to the topic of the West. Especially the leading country of the West, the United States of America, being some kind of participating in the overthrowing of the government in Ukraine. So my question is it true or not true that Victoria Nuland admitted, I think it was December 2013, in front of the flags of Exxon and Chevron, by the way, that how happy she is, how much the United States reached by only financing $5 billion of the Ukrainian to get their like a regime change or to the peace movement. Is it true or not true?
I can answer that. My moral is saying to me that listening to someone else's phone conversation is not a moral sin. But if you are listening to that, make
sure. That was a public statement. I think you're referring to the EU.
No, I'm referring to alleged phone conversation, and it's not good to listen to others' phone conversations. And if you are eavesdropping on someone else, please make sure that you do not take words out of the context, first of all. And then when you bring up all these recordings, we can endlessly discuss how genuine they are. So if you can prove that the conversation was genuine and she was jubilant about overthrowing Yanukovych, but Yanukovych left himself. He was not overthrown by the US.
No, but there was a different question about the 5 billion. I don't remember anything about 5 billion whatsoever. I remember them discussing figures, particular figures in the government and who they would prefer. Well, okay, that's
I think that
right
was in the testimony to the U.S. Congress, and I'm sorry for.
Well, why would the Chevron and Shell flags be on the background of testimony in the Congress?
So we just don't know what we are talking about now.
Can I make a very quick point on that, because it would be in defense of Ukrainians? I think she did make that comment that it was investment in social and civic promotion in Ukraine. And actually, the United States made the same kind of investment in Russia as well. It financed a lot of educational programs. I'm myself beneficiary of these programs, so the United States invested in me quite a bit as well. So I don't think we should blame the United States for that. I think that their instincts on that front perhaps were good. I think the problem of Russia and the United States is the approach towards the way how to bring democracy to any given country. And I want to add on the conciliatory note and thank all of you for participation and stress the role of Austria in the European affairs. I know that your country has long been maintaining neutrality as far as foreign policy is concerned. And I think for us, Russians and Ukrainians and the Americans, to settle our differences, we need a strong Europe, a Europe with its own opinion that may be similar to the United States, but doesn't toe every American sort of line or every American policy. I think Austria would be a good example of that, because it had a difficult relationship, sometimes not so difficult relationship with the Soviet Union. It has relationship with Europe, Eastern Europe, and it benefited from that. I really hope that you guys, you Austrians and the Europeans, could take some sort of middle ground when it comes to affairs between Russians and Ukrainians, and I'm sure that's our best hope, our best common hope for security in Europe and for the reconciliation in the conflict that we are all now observing.
And I, on the other hand, hope that the Austrians do not take the middle ground and call the black, and the white, the white. And where there is an invasion, it's an invasion.
And just to finish, I would disagree with this divide and rule approach, like Europe is good and US is bad, let's split and rule together. I would totally disagree, and I think that there any system built on this premise is absolutely unreliable and would never work in the society.
We could discuss on and on and on. Thank you very much. Thanks you, Philipp and Erste Stiftung and Mrs. Koeniger for the organization, also the Diplomatic Academy. Thank you all for coming, and thank you for your discipline. I guess it was an interesting discussion. Good evening.
Thank you.